Hello guys and welcome to my Starbase tutorial. Eight important topics when designing and maintaining your custom ship. So this is a video that I planned to do for you because I ran into some issues when using Starship Creator in Starbase, and maybe you can also avoid some of the mistakes I made by me showing you how things work and what I found out about this. This video will be recorded all in one take because I'm too lazy to edit it, but I prepared some scenes in OBS, so we will record this all in one go. And I will show you in Starship Creator and also in-game what is important about these single topics. So first, let's go through the eight different topics that I want to talk about, and then each topic will be shown in action in the game. So number one will be ship planning and framing and plating your ship. Number two will be angled shapes. Number three will be cargo and ship integrity. Number four will be cables, pipes, and networking. Number five will be the socket tool. Number six will be YOLOL, so the programming language. Number seven will be testing and analysis, so analyzing your ship and finding out what the problems are. And number eight will be making changes and repairing in space. So let's start with number one, ship planning, framing, and plating. So let's go into the Starship Creator. Maybe one first thing that I can already mention here is that sometimes you end up in this first person control camera. That happens if you press I on your keyboard. So also that's an issue for me sometimes when you are changing your YOLO code or you are using typing names or something. If you type I, same as in in-game, I is switching from mouse control to the cursor. So in case you run into this issue, you just press I and you can switch back to your mouse control. Now, this is my first ship. I have made a much bigger and better one, but just to show you how I started planning a new ship is that I just started playing around with the beams, seeing how they connect and seeing how things can be put together. So basically first, when you plan a ship, you think about a shape, maybe make a little sketch of it, and then you start putting the frames together and also already plan how you will put the plates on, because not every frame is easy to plate. So some things that you put together in terms of frames cannot be plated because there is a limited amount of plates in the editor and sometimes things don't really fit. So I recommend also already thinking about plating your ship when creating the frame or trying to create some plates for it to make sure that it in the end is plateable, basically. As you can see here, when and that's something I will talk about when we will discuss angled shapes also, is that you can make angled beams here, but sometimes they won't fit together, and that's what the problem was here. So sometimes the length doesn't fit. I mean, you can put a beam on top of it, but it is not nice. So that's basically what I wanted to show here. Let me just open my most recent ship. So I can show you when you put some hours into it, what things can look like. Also about planning, framing and plating a ship is that it's important at a certain point that you switch off your plates or even your beams and you can switch the visibility here and you can lock them so they're not selectable. So when you click these locks here, so basically that's what my windows are always switched to so I don't accidentally select them. But you can, for example, also lock the beams. So right now I cannot select any beams, but they are visible. So you have two switches, one is for visibility, one is for locking them. And you can imagine that when the ship is bigger and more complex, that it really is important to switch things off and on in terms of visibility and selection. Now that's basically already it about planning your ship, framing and plating. Let's start with the second topic, which is then the angled shapes. So that also plays a bit into planning and framing and plating. But let's have a look at angled shapes. So for example, my basic concept here was, and that's what I started with, is that I created such a corner because I wanted a ship which doesn't look like a box, because most ships in the beginning they just look like a box, and if you don't plan this out in the beginning, you will end up having issues with it. So it makes sense to already start with angled parts like the corners and also find out how plates can fit on top here. So basically, I started with this part. Then also, what is important is that you need to, sorry, you need to plan how big one of these grid parts will be. As you can see, my cargo boxes are a bit smaller than one of these grid parts. Maybe if I would make a new ship, I would plan a different grid size, basically. And also in terms about angled shapes, so here, as you can see, my mining lasers, they are in a 45 degree angle attached to the ship. And that was kind of a tedious process to get the frame connected here and also to plate this stuff off, because you will run into issues here if these things don't fit together. So it took me quite a while to get a good plating onto this angled shape. So you should really start with a basic angled frame of your beams, like it's the case here, connected to the rest of your ship, and then start thinking about how to plate it and put this onto your ship. Also, what an issue later on is when talking about integrity is that sometimes if you put, like, that's why I put this cover on top of here. It is kind of an issue to close off angled platings here, where they come together. So there's just limited curved plates, for example, like these things here, and they don't fit always. So it's not that easy to put that inside of here just and be happy. Also, the snapping sometimes is weird. So this can be an issue. So make sure that you plan it correctly and also that you plan ahead when creating these angled shapes. Let's undo this. You can also see about these bolts. So the bolts will be removed when you move parts. So this then will be not connected to the ship anymore. Also there's a button up here, show detached objects. So this will instantly show all shapes that are not connected to your ship. Also be careful when moving around things. I'm quite often using number one and number two for rotating and moving parts. Yeah, so that's it about angle shapes. So let's talk about cargo and integrity. So cargo was a problem for me. So my first version of this ship had really annoying issues. So when I was mining, I don't know for what reason, but my cargo containers turned red in play mode, and there were integrity issues with the ship, so it wouldn't fly fast anymore. So also keep in mind, if one of your ship parts becomes loose or something, your ship will not fly fast anymore. So you need to fix this unless you have to travel with a really slow distance. And sometimes fixing this in space can be really annoying, which was the case for me. And here was a problem with my cargo containers because they had too many bolts. So that's also very, really something very important to know. It isn't always good to put a whole lot of bolts onto your ship, because each part, and also cargo especially, because each part will lose integrity when you put too many bolts into it. And that was the issue here. So as you can see, my bolts are just, I think 4 bolts is the number of each part that makes the best integrity. And if you get above 6 or 7, then it will lose integrity again. So that's really something that you should keep in mind. Yeah, cargo and integrity. Another thing about integrity, which took me a bit to figure out. So when you go to this durability tool here and you click your ship with the left mouse button, it will analyze your ship and it will show integrity issues. So right now, if nothing is selected, you can see your ship warp class, which is 1.87 here. And if you unbolt things, it will lose integrity. And the lowest part in terms of integrity will bring down your warp class. So basically, one of the parts here, I think it's the radiators on top, they have the lowest integrity. So you can see it has 1.87. And if I, for example, remove a bolt from here, now I switch to the bolt tool, make a right click on one of the bolts, and then you can see it's turning red. And now if I go back into the durability analyzer and deselect the box, you can see now my ship warp class dropped to 0.23, which is quite low. Now I undo this and it's back to about 2. Now, also, what is kind of confusing sometimes, I fixed most of the integrity issues, but for example, if you click these boxes, it's kind of confusing sometimes what is the part that is selected. But the box will be basically in the middle of the bounding box of the meant object. So this box here is talking about this green angled shape here. And the rest around it will turn into a translucent texture or transparent texture. So you better are able to see the part. And also the bolts that hold it together with the rest will be highlighted. So this makes it easier for you to identify which part is meant. For example, here, this a right click does this. I don't use this already, but let's stay in this mode. So here my, because there is no name written, but it means my, my thruster box or thruster casing, basically. So this way you can see which part is what. So let's click this box. This might be the cargo container, yes. So here you can see that would be the next part if I would fix my radiators. I think I cannot bring them up more than 1.87 at this point. But if I would fix them, I can go to the next part, which is this box here, and increase integrity by adding bolts. But as you can see, I already have 6 bolts in it, and this will not, I will not be able to increase it as far as I know. So if you have any information about how I can increase my ship integrity in terms of radiators and cargo boxes, please let me know in the comments, because I'm also interested in that. But as far as I know, I was not able to increase it above 1.8, 1.9, about this. Okay, so when you use the durability tool and you select parts, you can still stay in the durability mode, which can be also quite useful. After your final or your basic construction is created, you can switch to durability mode and still work in your scene, change part positions, bolting, and so on, and everything will be visualized in different colors. So yellow and red are lesser integrity values then. Okay, let's switch off durability mode here, and let's go to number 4, which is cables, pipes, and networking. Sorry. So cables, pipes, and networking. So I recommend finishing your ship parts that you want to use, and make sure that everything that you want to install in your ship, like all the mining lasers, all the ore collectors, all the thrusters, all the maneuvering thrusters, so basically everything that needs electricity and pipes, is installed in your ship before you start creating cables and pipes, and also your networking, which is these parts. Because when you make changes to your ship, sometimes these cables and pipes are in the way. So if I, for example, will remove or move this beam here around, for example, so let's just move this here. And if there is already cables and pipes in the way, as you can see, for this one it worked. Okay, so what happened here is you can see that when you start moving parts around where pipes and cables are attached to, basically, then these parts will be deleted, and sometimes you have leftovers, like, yeah, for example, if I delete this beam here and try to bring it back into its position, or copy the beam to the old place, it's not possible because the pipes and cables are in the way. So that's why it's kind of tedious to remove these and then put the beam again and then make the cables and pipes again. So I really recommend finishing off your frame and plating and everything first, and in the end you make your cables and pipes. Also, networking is very useful. So in your devices networking folder, you will find these ducts. So these ducts are used to basically network cables and pipes through your ship. So this means a duct contains automatically cable and pipe connections. And when you, as you can see here, this pipe is connected to this duct network, and the resources and the signal from the cables and pipes will be automatically distributed along all these network grids to whatever part of your ship that you like. So basically you can save a lot of objects that you create, so you don't have to paint your pipes. What I do is basically I can create a basic grid which goes through my ship, and then I start connecting the parts that need to be connected to my grid network or my duct network, like for example these hydrogen tanks, or like the thrusters or the generator and everything. So before creating cables and pipes, make a basic network that distributes everything through your ship, and then you start connecting up, and you just need to touch the ducts with cables or pipes, and that will connect them to the network. Okay, let's talk about number 5, which is the socket tool. The socket tool is something that I found pretty late, but it is really helpful. Because when you, for example, want to make a door and you want to have buttons inside and outside, what I did, I started making a hole into my hull inside and outside, and started changing the platings so my button base would fit inside there. But that's not necessary. So what you can do is you can create a socket, and the socket will automatically transform your signal from the inside to the outside of your platings and your ship. Even two or three platings will be transported through. So basically what you need to do is you just select the socket tool in your toolbar, and then you can see where the socket tool can place a socket, and this will then create a connection between the inside and outside of your ship, and also automatically place a cable between them, which then you can connect like I did it here, and then you can put your buttons on it. Now, one thing that is also important to know about the socket tool, because when you start deleting these sockets, you will end up having, let me just turn off the plate selection, you will end up having these leftover cables in your ship. And you can even, with a right click, you can remove cables, but this doesn't work for former sockets. So the problem is that these are somehow still recognized as a socket and will not be removable with the cable tool. You can select them like so, like a cable. So make a box around it. I can still select them, so it's repairable. But what is even easier than that is that you simply use the socket tool to remove this again. So when you click the socket tool and you make a right click on your socket, it will remove both the cable and the inside and outside socket. So yeah, in case you want to place buttons that connect the inside and outside of your ship, and or also make displays or things from inside to outside, then use the socket tool. Okay, let's go on with number 6, which is YOLOL. So YOLOL is the programming language that can be used to do more complex things. So for example, what is not by default in the game. Also a little tip for you: if you are in test mode and you try out your ship and you are always flying with your jetpack, you can press G on your keyboard, which will activate your magnetic boots. So this way you can walk around in your ship instead of flying through it, with which is also a bit faster than flying. Now I wanted to show you what is possible with YOLOL. I didn't do too complex things with it. I just made some basic things, but I created this ship with three different YOLOL chip sockets and chips in it. So when I buy this ship, I will be later on be able still to play around with code and improve on the functionalities of my ship, even if my ship is already built or created. So I would also recommend for you at least having one or two YOLOL chip sockets in your ship that you connect to your cable network, so you are later on, also when your ship is already built, able to start playing around with coding and automizing things with programming your ship. So now I just wanted to show you something very basic that I made with YOLO. So here is my mining lasers that I can change the distance with. Basically, I'm planning also to program this that it will be automatically working with a rangefinder. So the rangefinder will point at an asteroid and then it will automatically triangulate the distance and the rotation of these mining lasers, so I don't have to control this by hand. But I just want to have the basic parts and functionality there, so I can also do it in space when I'm bored from mining. I can start playing around with code, for example. So what I wanted to show you about YOLOL is, you can see my lasers, they are not constantly active. They turn off and on, which can be easily done by using YOLOL. So basically you can see it does three times bzz, 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 and then it makes a little break, and this way I can control them. Here's my up and down functionality, so I don't have to navigate my ship, and I can start harvesting asteroids without turning my ship, which can be a bit annoying. So so how is this done, that my lasers are not constantly beaming but they turn on and off? Not sure if which chip it is. I think it's this one. Yeah, so that's my mining laser code. You can see it right now, it's jumping from 1 to 9. That's because the button is inactive. So what's happening here is that if my laser button, this is the signal coming from my button, is switched on, it will start going to line 2. And then 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, and then it will go back to 1. Check if the button is on, and if the button is off, so else, so this means if this is something else, not on, it will go to 9. So it means it switches off the laser, and then check again if something has changed. So that's a very basic if loop. Important is to add end in the end here. I learned this from another guy from a YouTube video, so maybe check out some YouTube videos about programming YOLOL. I will not go too much into detail about it. What I wanted to just recommend to you guys is, as I said, start setting up or think about something that you want to do later on, like for example my mining laser triangulation, and then put the things in here, and then you can start programming when you are in space and when you are bored from mining. So that's basically my laser pitch that's already there. It's just, you could also do this just with buttons, but it is the basic setup, so I can start coding in here. So that's it about the YOLOL. Maybe also show off the socket connection in here. So that is how this socket connects the door on the inside and outside. Okay. F5 basically means test mode on and off. And that was number 6. Now let's get into number 7, which is testing and analyzing your ship. So before you buy your ship that you have constructed, you need to test it out. So really make sure that everything is working. The more complex your ship gets, the more things are there that need to be tested. So for example, what is this here? So with you have your universal tool and can look at these things. So for example, what I did yesterday is I made these cooling cell recharge units, and I wanted to try if they work. So I don't want to be by the ship and then be in space and find out that it's not working. So it doesn't make any sense. So basically, to test this out, you can press look at the cooling cell, press E and use the mouse wheel to bring it a bit closer. Then you can press X and move your, or hold X and move your mouse up and down for the X axis. Y is tilting it to the side, and Z is rotating it around the upper axis. And this way now I can try out my cooling recharger and put this inside. If it doesn't snap inside, press C to activate snap. And then you can see now it has snapped. Now I press E again. And as you can see, the cooling cell recharger is working. So you can see that the red bar is moving away. And this way I know that my cooling cell recharger works, and I can place this back in here. Some of the things need to be bolted. So when I'm in space, I always bolt my cooling cells. Otherwise they are not connected to the ship. Sometimes it works, sometimes not, but I really prefer bolting them down. Okay. So also about testing and analysis, if you buy your ship already and you are in space, make sure that you have all your tools with you. I made another video about the bolt tool because that was bugged for me, so I had to sell it and buy a new one. I don't know, it was just bugged. It was not able to work, so I needed to sell it and buy a new one. Yeah, so let's see, testing and analysis. What else? So it is important to make sure that all things are working before you buy your ship. So also about analysis, what's important is you don't want to have a ship where you don't have any visual representation of what is going on right now. So how much electricity are my generators producing, how much battery power I have, how much is still in my fuel rod, how much hydrogen I have left, how much is in my cooling cells. Make sure that you have, what are these components called, progress bars that show all these things. Otherwise you will fly around and you always have to look at the bars on your ship. But this way I can instantly see what is empty, what needs to be refueled. I see so many people ending up in space calling for emergency help, basically to get a lift or someone that brings fuel or something because they just ran into being out of fuel. I guess because they don't have any visual representation how much is in there. So try to avoid this. Yeah, about also an analysis. So of course, when this here works, I can basically see that instantly in action. But sometimes when this is not working, for example, it is important to find where the problem is. So that's not really nice. So with the U tool in test mode, you can, and when you press I, you can move your mouse cursor, and here you can see that this lever is now changing its value. I named it to laser distance, and when I see that the value is changing, I know that this value is now going into the system, and now I need to just make sure that this will be distributed to the object. So now it's 33.27 is the value, and this value will not go into the laser itself, but into this, yeah, what's it called? Cradle to pitch up and down. So now if I look at the cradle, you can see that the laser pitch, so the signal coming from the button, is getting there and is changing the angle. In case you have to rename the field for the pitch also to the same value as your lever is giving. And in case it doesn't move, the problem must be in between the lever and this thing. So if the signal doesn't end up getting here, there must be some issue in your circuit. So make sure that all the things are connected and make sure that your signal is making it to your hard points. So all these things are important to make sure your ship is working. And once you are sure that everything is fine, then you can start buying your ship. And the final thing that I want to show now is changing and repairing in space. So sometimes making changes and repairing in space is kind of confusing because it doesn't work like in the editor. You have to have the tools and everything, and that's why I want to show this now in the last chapter of this video. So when your ship is ready, you can buy your ship. That's a little side note here. So you have to save your blueprint first. I will not save this. I don't know which changes I made. Let's just open. Maybe I want to show you a former version of this ship here, so you can see where it was coming from. Let's open this one. So this took me quite some time to build, so don't think that you are not able to put something together like this. You just need some time and play with it. So as you can see, that was my basic setup, which is kind of different. The cockpit I was not very happy with because I couldn't see anything below that. You can see I just have three panels here. But that's kind of the evolution of my ship. My cargo containers are differently aligned and everything. Now, if your blueprint is finished and saved, you can go to File and then choose Buy Custom Spaceship. And then you will get at first the credits that you need to buy it and also the ores that you need to build it. And it will tell you how much is still needed in terms of money and materials. Now, let's exit the spaceship designer and get one of my ships that I built, which is the 4th former version of the ship that I was showing before. That is this one. I will spawn it. Okay, here it is. And also I wrote, so I tried this ship, I flew around with it and I made some notes what I still need. So what I changed is I added the two mining lasers left and right. I changed the cockpit so I can see what's below me. I put the ore collector on bottom, added a range finder, made backward thrusters so I can also brake when I approach an asteroid, which is also quite important. And yeah, all these little things. Now this is the version from before. Now I'm not in the editor, I'm now in the game and I can now fly and... Oh, there's no coolant in here. So I still have some battery, so let's go in space. And that's a good example to show you how can you maintain your ship in space and how can you encounter problems like, for example, the coolant. So my coolant is empty, as you can see. I will switch off the generator now. And now I exit my seat, have a look at my cooling racks. And as you can see, they are empty. I don't have these recharging things already here. So I need to find a way to get these cooling things out. At first they are bolted, so you cannot simply take them out. So I need to take my bolt tool and at first remove the bolts. And then I can pick these things up. Okay, now what I recommend if you are in space, I'm next to my space, to the space station, so I still have all the materials here. But if I'm not, I don't have any materials, so I cannot craft new cooling cells. So that's why I'm also carrying some Norgite, because with Norgite and a workbench, you can craft new cells. I also need some Bastium, I think, yeah. Let's put this in here, maybe a full stack. And also why I built these recharging racks is because these empty cooling cells, they are just annoying. If you mix them up with full cooling cells, you don't recognize if it's full or if it's empty, and it's just annoying. So that's why before I had these charging racks, I was just throwing them away and made new ones. So I just dropped them here. I mean, you can see it on the display, but it's annoying to craft new ones and then mix them up in your inventory. So, how do you craft cooling cells or cooling cells? So, let's go here to power, ship parts, let's search this, cool, here, small cooling cell full. So I can craft this right now because I'm in a station, but what is the issue when you don't have a workbench close by? That's why I always carry a workbench with me. So make sure that you have a workbench with you that you can then place. You don't have to bolt it down. I just I don't like to have it bolted to my ship. I just put it here, and now with the materials in my inventory, I can make new cooling cells. So let's make these. full. Make sure you make full cooling cells. Let's make 3 ones. And let's get them into our inventory. Here they are. Put them on the quick bar. Pick up the workbench again and now take the cooling cells. And place them. You can left click or press E again to place them and also make sure they are bolted. Where did this go? Okay. Kind of weird. Let's just skip this one. So the bolting is sometimes a bit weird. And let's have a look at our cooling now. So the coolant is recharged again. I have 2 cooling cells with each 5,000 units in it. So that should be fine to lie a bit. As you can see now, when starting the generator, it will go down and deplete the cooling cells. Okay, another thing about repairing, maintaining and making changes to your ship is, that's why I said make sure everything is already designed and planned in your ship before buying it. As you can see, I made this ship, I bought it, but I instantly went back to the garage to redesign it, because the changes that I made in the Starship Designer would take too long to make them in space. Of course, you can remove plates and put new plates, but it's much more work to do. So make sure your blueprint is already finalized. Now, the problem that I had with my cargo containers in space, that they were turning red. Basically, I had an integrity error and I was unable to find out where the integrity is displayed. I knew it from the Starship creator that the integrity is displayed with the toolbar icon there, but I didn't know how to show the integrity in the in-game mode. To do this, you use your universal tool with U, and then you press you look at some part that will display the data, the blueprint on the left side. So let's sometimes it won't display now. As you can see, you have to look at something different. And then when your blueprint is displayed, you can switch to the durability mode. And now you are able to see the things that need to be rebolted or need to be aligned different. So what you can do is, because what was also very annoying for me is that some of the bolts are for me unreachable. They are behind that bar and I'm unable. So if I wanted to do the bolting manually, I would have to remove these plates and then get behind the part, which is very annoying. And what you can do is, what took me quite a while, is you can when you hold your right mouse button with the bolt tool, you can unbolt the parts. And now you can see this thing is detached, or it's red, which means it's not detached yet. Now, if the blue thingy around it is displayed, I can take out the box and move it to a different place with E, or I can put it back in. And by holding the left mouse button, can see now it's red, so there's just 2 bolts or 1 in it, and by holding the left mouse button it will start bolting the thing automatically in certain places. So that's how you would do the repairs in space. Don't forget to switch off the durability mode. And now that is it for everything I wanted to show you, which are my experiences using the Starship Creator and also how to maintain and repair your ship in space. If you liked the video, give me a thumbs up, subscribe and comment. I will also answer the comments below. And if you have any more questions or suggestions, what videos you want to see from me, just go ahead and write it in the comments. I will stream from time to time, so you can find me on Twitch under Survivor. I will also put it in the description. I will also try to put chapters in the video, which I didn't do so far, so you can just go to the chapters that you need. I maybe should have said this in the beginning of the video, but as I said, this is all recorded in one take. So with that said, have a nice time creating your starship. Don't run into the same issues that I had. I hope I could help you a bit, and have a nice day and see you in the next one. Bye bye.